Hi, Dr. Rajiv. How are you?
Hi, Dr. Rajiv. Sorry, I hope I am not late.
You are on time, not on time.
Okay. It's fine. I was a little worried that I might get late today.
No. You are on time. So, should we start?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Great. Let me just activate the YouTube for a second. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 12D, the fourth lecture in the respiratory pathology. And we are streaming live from TMH Mumbai via Kolkata. A very, very interesting topic, very relevant in today's practice, approach to small lung biopsies. Slowly and slowly, FNA of the lung is being replaced by TrueCut lung biopsies. And thus, this lecture becomes very important for all the people who are trying to learn pathology and also people who are trying to practice pathology. And to talk on that, we have an expert, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Kaushal, who is a professor in the Department of Pathology in the Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. He received his medical degree from Grant Medical College, Mumbai, after which he did his 3 years senior residency in PGI, Chandigarh. He rejoined Tata Memorial Hospital as assistant professor, and now he is the professor in the Department of Pathology. His special interest in thoracic, gastrointestinal and oncopathology, molecular pathology and digital pathology. Mayo Clinic has awarded him the Geraldine C. Zeeler's Fellowship to participate in Mayo Clinic Visiting Clinical Program at Arizona, USA, for training in pulmonary pathology. So you can see, he's an expert in pulmonary pathology. He's also the recipient for Terry Fox Research Grant. In addition to routine diagnostic work, he also looks after administrative activity and is establishing the digital pathology network across various centers of TMC. He has got multiple publications, national and international, a very famous person in oncopathology and especially lung pathology. Before I ask Dr. Kaushal to take over, let me request you to keep your mic muted, your camera off. Please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Rajiv Kaushal, sir, please share your screen and let us start.
Good evening, everyone, and thanks, Dr. Nadeem, for the kind invitation and such a nice introduction. So today talk, as Dr. Nadeem has briefed, we are going to talk about the diagnostic approach on the small lung biopsy and how this field is evolving. So to brief you, there are many diseases which can involve the lung, and as a pulmonary pathologist, we play a very crucial role in assisting the clinicians to reach a conclusive diagnosis. So we have to keep in mind that when we are dealing with these lung biopsies, the diagnosis is not limited to the cancers or the granulomatous disease, but a variety of the other conditions also we have to become familiar with. So, as a what is our role as a surgical pathologist? We have to keep in mind, in some cases, we don't come into the picture, and the clinical and the radiological profile of the patient is very classical, and the clinicians don't need any biopsy diagnosis or cytology diagnosis in these cases. But there are some cases in which our role is very pivotal. And what are those cases which has a diagnostic dilemma and which might show the clinical and radiological discordances? So those are the cases in which our role become very pivotal, because in those cases clinicians look for assistance from us, because they are not sure what's going inside. And we have to keep in mind that whenever we are evaluating these lesions, the diagnosis should fit into the clinical profile. And so always check for the relevant clinical history when you are dealing with these biopsies. So we should not hesitate to ask for the clinical and radiological images from the clinicians, because most of the time, in addition to these small biopsy samples, the clinical history, they are also either one line, or even they just mention that this is a lung biopsy and nothing else is given to us. So the history plays a very pivotal role, especially when you are dealing with a small size sample. And but that is due to the inadequate or tissue biopsy sample, but the disease is very florid, and clinically they just want a confirmation on the tissue diagnosis. So and especially in the non-neoplastic lung disease, like interstitial lung disease, that will be discussed in the subsequent talks. So in those scenarios, the clinical and radiological information is very, very important. And I will emphasize, so if you don't get a good clinical history, so many times your report ends with the long descriptions, and which further confuse the clinicians without making any definitive diagnosis. These are the few of the practical challenges which we encounter when we are dealing with these biopsies. And main challenge in the thoracic lesions is the acquisition of the sample and how we process them. So I'll just like to stress on some of these points, because as the topic itself says, approach of small biopsy, so tissue is always an issue, and it is many times very difficult to put a needle into the lung and to obtain a good amount of the tissue, because it depends on the expertise of our intervention radiologist, and many times they are very scared of getting the pneumothorax. So that in our hospital now most of the procedures which we the samples which we encounter, especially primarily from the lung, are the biopsy, and we don't and the cytology specimens has drastically reduced. Although we are cancer driven center, but that is the practice now coming all across the globe. As I said, we need the tissue not only to make the morphological diagnosis, but further characterization is also important as per the new WHO classification. And if it is a malignant lesion, then the molecular testing is also important. So which sample is the best or which approach is the best? So these are the list of some of the samples which respiratory specimens, out of which the most common which we encounter are the transthoracic needle core biopsies or endobronchial biopsies. So in some centers, including our centers, we are also started doing the cryo biopsies, which can give a good amount of the tissue. Besides that, the majority of the specimens includes transthoracic lung biopsies or bronchoscopic biopsy. So these are this paper has illustrated the diagnostic yield of the various samples and including the adequacy for the biomarker testing. So the choice of the sample, it all depends on the where the lesion is located. If it is a central lesion, then you can target that even with the bronchoscopy and obtain a good amount of the tissue. But if it is a peripheral lesion, then the interventional radiologist has to go through the transthoracic approach. Few recommendations when these are not to the pathologist but to the interventional radiologist or the pulmonologist who are obtaining these biopsies. First and foremost, we have to educate them or tell them that don't give us only one biopsy core. So many times they just pluck one small tiny bit of bronchial mucosa and they feel that this is sufficient to yield a diagnosis, but that is not sufficient. So if they give us the more number of the tissue cores, we end up giving a definitive and conclusive diagnosis. And further, many times we end up getting only the superficial mucosal bits, and so the deeper tissue which has possibly a lesion is missed by the pulmonologist. So the pulmonologist should be trained to obtain a good good number of the biopsies, but also to obtain the deeper representative tissue. So these are usually the biopsies obtained from these cupped forceps, and so the biopsy tissue should be very carefully removed either using the sterile needle or from these cupped forceps. So if you don't remove this tissue properly, it can end up with a lot of crushing artifacts which interfere with the morphological evaluation. And further, when the pulmonologist they put the sample in a formalin or the saline, they should try to agitate or shake the tube a little bit, because the air which is entrapped will come out and the tissue will expand properly. So these are the few of the recommendations which are to be adopted when obtaining this biopsy. And ideally, the sample should be put in the formalin, and never it should be put on the cotton gauze, because sometimes we get the sample which is put on the cotton mesh, and while removing these sample, these tiny specimens become very tricky, and we might lose some of the tissue bit. As I mentioned earlier, the cryobiopsy, which is all good alternative to the open lung biopsies, and plays a very important role in picking up the opportunistic infections and ILDs. So ideally, whenever you are dealing with these biopsy, it is recommended to obtain minimum of 3 biopsy cores and possibly biopsy from the different areas, or even if in case of the interstitial lung disease, it is recommended even to sample the different lobes of the lung to give a conclusive diagnosis. And whenever there are cytology specimens, it is better to convert them into a cell block. And this is the technique which is called the rapid on-site evaluation. So we in our hospital, especially whenever there are difficult lesions, or if the lesions which are or especially in those cases which are repeat biopsy, the adequacy of the specimen is tested by using the touch imprints of the biopsy specimens, and so that the repeat biopsy can be obtained immediately. So recently the College of American Pathologists has given guidelines about the handling and the collection of these specimens, small biopsies as well as the cytology specimens. Which is used for cytology specimens, especially for the EBUS guided TBNA. So these guidelines strongly recommend the use of rapid on-site evaluation while doing this procedure. So if the facility for the rapid on-site evaluation is not available, then ideally minimum of 3 to five passes should be done before assessing the adequacy of the samples. And for thoracic coronal biopsy, the procedure should also the minimum of three tissue cores should be obtained. So the radiologist should not give you only one or two tissue cores when we are dealing with this specimen. So this was about the acquisition of the samples and how to get a good amount of sample of these small biopsy samples from the interventional radiologist or pulmonologist. Now, after the sample it has been removed from body, it is now a responsibility of a pathologist to take care of it. And we have to make ensure that the specimen should be proper, should be fixed immediately in 10% neutral buffer formalin. If clinically the suspicion of infection is there, the sample should be collected in the saline, and the saline samples for the microbiological evaluation should go to microbiology department and not the histopath lab, because many times we see the specimens which is collected in normal saline is sent to histopath lab, and which is of no use to the histopathologist, because most of when we process this many times it will show autolytic changes. Further important thing, both over fixation and under fixation is hazardous for ISC processing and the molecular testing. And because many of these cases go for the molecular testing, we have to ensure that the adequate fixation of the specimen when the clinical suspicion of malignancy is there should be done. So as I mentioned, that it's our responsibility of a pathologist to act as a guardian of this tissue and handle this tissue very judiciously so that they should not be compromised. So now this practice which we adopt in our hospital, we told our interventional radiologist to put the sample in two blocks, two containers, so that it can be divided, and at least two blocks can be made, and one is used for the routine histopath diagnosis and other for the molecular diagnosis. After these samples are processed and they are ready to cut, we have to take care that only the expert histotechnician should handle these precious samples. And because many times we have seen that even in cases of malignancy, multiple serial deep cuts were done and put on for one single HE sections, which is just a waste of the tissue, because with such a large amount of the sample, it can all possible molecular tests for this particular patient could have been done. But at the end, when the block was sent for the molecular diagnosis, the tissue was left inadequate. So whenever you encounter such conditions, situations, we have to make sure that you talk to your lab staff and the technician, and inform that you should avoid these situations. So the serial deep cuts are very useful whenever if you are dealing with the benign pathology, because many times we have seen the granulomas appear only after doing the multiple serial deep cuts. So in those situations, serial deep cuts should be done. So that was about the handling of these small biopsies. And now comes the role of a pathologist, that is like a analytic morphological interpretation of these small tissue bits. So when we are dealing with this these biopsies, the first thing is we have to broadly categorize the lesion into two major subgroups, because although we in Tata Hospital we are predominantly cancer driven, I do a cancer driven practice, but the first step is it a malignancy or not, or if it is not malignancy, what is the morphological patterns you are seeing in that particular case. So why it is important, because the histological patterns, especially in case of the interstitial lung disease or disease, or even the granulomatous disease, give you idea you are dealing with which definitive subcategory of the pathology. So the morphological patterns can be like a histological unique, they can be characteristic, or it can be driven by the pattern of injury. So, and at the end we have to correlate all these features with the clinical and radiological pictures. So and while coming to the neoplastic lesions, if you are seeing a on these small core biopsies, you can see this this is a core which is showing minimum of 5 to 6 tissue cores, which is regarded as a good lung biopsy samples. So initially this sample is subjected to histomorphological evaluation based on HE followed by ISC confirmation, and depending on the type of the tumor, molecular characterization of this is done. So that means if you are dealing with the lung cancer and using this small biopsy, you have to be very careful. And now as a pathologist, we are in catch-22 situation, because the aim should be not limited only to establish a diagnosis of malignancy, but with the idea to help the patient till end, when when this tissue will go for the subsequent molecular testing. So now my subsequent talk will be mainly focused on the diagnostic approach of the of small biopsies on the lung on the cancerous lesions. And as we know, the traditional view of the lung cancer carcinoma, that is small cell and non-small cell carcinoma, is no longer now relevant, and as a pathologist we have to characterize these lesions into definitive subgroups. And why it is important, because this is clinically relevant because there are different therapies for depending on the histological subtype. So this is the I can say this might be my last presentation using this 2015 classification, because the new WHO edition is going to be released anytime, and it is almost released, and some of the recommendations are already out in the public domain. But till that, the 2015 WHO classification, it emphasizes about the definitive characterization of the non-small cell carcinoma group into various subdivisions. And so even in the small biopsy or cytology specimens, they should be characterized into the specific subtypes like adenocarcinoma and squamous carcinoma. And if the morphology alone can't give you the solution, we have to rely on the ancillary techniques and techniques like ISC and the special stains. Further, it is important to remember, many times pathologists end up giving a diagnosis of large cell carcinoma on the biopsy specimens. So it is recommended by the WHO not to restrict this the terminology large cell carcinoma only to the on the resection specimen, when morphologically, even after you morphologically or by ISC, you fail to establish the definitive lineage. The few recommendations which are now everyone is well averse with, that the terminology of bronchoalveolar carcinoma is not to be used, which is replaced by the the terms that adenocarcinoma with lipidic pattern, and if it is minimally invasive with the minimally invasive adenocarcinoma. And so when we are dealing, so although this diagnosis, that adenocarcinoma in situ and minimally invasive adenocarcinoma, are based you can make with certainty only on the resection specimens, but if you are seeing any lesion on the biopsy, which shows purely lipidic growth pattern. So you have to go back and check the imaging findings. And if on imaging the lesion is less than 3 cm, you have to give a diagnosis as an adenocarcinoma with lipidic pattern. And in the comment section, you have to make kindly correlate clinical radiologically as the possibility of invasive adenocarcinoma cannot be ruled out. So diagnosis of adenocarcinoma in situ you should not make on the biopsy specimens. And what are the so if the pure lipidic pattern means it is growing along the alveolar septae and there is no desmoplastic or the stromal response, there are you will not see any evidence of emboli and none of the other morphological patterns. In addition, in the adenocarcinoma subgroup, there are various histological patterns can be observed, and these patterns, although when you are dealing with the resection specimen, you have to give them in what percentage of the pattern is present in the resection specimen, but it is that if any but these patterns can be described in the biopsy, because in the resection the picture might be completely different. But there are some patterns like in solid adenocarcinoma and micropapillary, these are associated with the poor prognostic and outcome. So even if on the biopsy you observe these patterns, you should document it, because they are associated with the bad outcomes. In the current scenario, so what is expected when from a pathologist when we deal with these small biopsies? As I mentioned earlier, that we have to give a conclusive diagnosis not only using the morphological features but also by using the immunohistochemistry, and this is the one area in which ISC is very much relevant, but many centers don't have the facility for immunohistochemistry. So I'll tell you in which cases ISC is really required for the definitive characterization. So is immunohistochemistry mandatory? Yes, it is mandatory, but we have to be judicious in using the ISC, because if you do a lot of immunohistochemistry markers, then the tissue will not be spared for the molecular testing. So this is a diagnostic algorithm which you have to keep in mind when we are dealing with these small biopsy specimens. As first step is the morphologic or histomorphological evaluation, and if based on the histomorphological evaluation you are very much certain about the definitive lineage of these cases, then you can even avoid the immunohistochemistry. Like if there is a pure lipidic growth pattern or nice gland formation and the patient has a single lung lesion, then the immunohistochemistry might not be required. And if the tumor shows keratinization with nice intercellular bridges and morphologically quite suggestive of squamous carcinoma, so these cases it can be avoided. But if you have to do the immunohistochemistry, always starts with the minimum lung panel, that is one squamous carcinoma marker and one adenocarcinoma marker, that is TTF1 or P40, which we use commonly in our setting. Or so if a tumor which shows a neuroendocrine morphology, in those cases you should do neuroendocrine markers, because if a tumor is morphologically not showing the neuroendocrine markers morphology and you end up throwing the neuroendocrine markers, sometimes you can see the focal expression and then you are in diagnostic dilemma. So after you have done ISC and it has given you a definitive lineage, then the diagnostic term which is to be used is a non-small cell carcinoma, favor adenocarcinoma or squamous carcinoma based on the histological, based on the ISC profile, and these cases are subsequently subjected to the molecular testing. So just to give you some illustration of few cases, like in this case, on cytology as well as on the morphology, you can appreciate the glandular or squamous differentiation. So in such cases, we don't need immunohistochemistry. But this is another case where the tumor is looking like a non-small cell carcinoma, and morphologically it was looking more like a squamous carcinoma, but to our surprise, the TTF1 came very strongly and diffusely positive, so it is a solid adenocarcinoma. So especially if the tumor on the core biopsy, it has a solid configuration, in those cases ISC is mandatory, because you can end up getting a surprise like we saw in this case. Another, sometimes you, when you do these markers, squamous or adenocarcinoma markers, you can encounter some situation in which these markers are positive, both markers are positive, and then do you call these cases adenosquamous carcinoma based on the dual expression? But so the recommendations say that you can get focal positivity for P63 or P40 even in adenocarcinoma cases. So any tumor which shows either diffuse or even focal expression for adenocarcinoma markers, like that is TTF1 or NAPSIN, it has to be labeled as non-small cell carcinoma favor adenocarcinoma. To label any case as squamous carcinoma, the expression for squamous marker has to be strong and diffuse. Then only, in this particular case, the expression, you can see it is coming in the same population of the cells. So this is adenocarcinoma and not adenosquamous carcinoma. For to label a case as adenosquamous carcinoma, the expression of these marker has to be in the separate areas. And sometime you will encounter the situations like in this case, there is a non-small cell carcinoma which is strongly positive for CK7, but the other markers are not giving very conclusive answer. Like there are occasional cells which areas which has TTF1 shows brown staining, but you are not very sure that this staining is in the tumor cells or they are entrapped pneumocytes. P40 is relatively some more cells, but another squamous marker is not helping us. So these cases should be left as a non-small cell carcinoma NOS, but we have to make an attempt that this category, the percentage of the cases which should fall in this category should be as minimal as possible. So this was about the conventional variety of the non-small cell carcinomas, including adenocarcinoma, squamous and adenosquamous. Now I will move to some more different patterns of the adenocarcinoma which can give you a problem. Like this is a case of a 61-year-old lady which presented with a headache, and there was a cystic lesion in the brain, and on at resection it shows a tumor which has a complete signet ring cell-like morphology. So see, on immunohistochemistry it is positive for CK7 and 20 was negative, and CDX2 was also negative. When you see the adenocarcinoma with signet ring cell appearance, the first possibility that arises that of adenocarcinoma of the stomach or from the GI tract. But being CDX2 negative, we have to do additional markers, and in this case the TTF1 and NAPSIN was very strongly and diffusely positive. So we have to keep in mind, especially in the metastatic sites, even if a tumor which shows a signet ring cell morphology, it can still be of primary pulmonary origin, and signet ring cell morphology is not a birthright of a GI tract tumor, and in these cases ISC is very much relevant. Another case which in this case also the morphologically there is a no problem in in saying that this is an adenocarcinoma or the squamous carcinoma. It is a very nice area which is showing adenocarcinoma, but the tumor has an extensive marked mucinous differentiation, and it is also growing along the septus. And the CK7 was nicely and strongly positive, and even the CK20 also shows the focal positivity. Then when we move to the lung specific adenocarcinoma markers, so although there is some brown staining is seen in some of the cells, but if you pay a close attention, the tumor cells are negative for TTF1, so which can be very well seen with the mucinous adenocarcinoma of the lung. They can be either be negative or focally positive for TTF1, and in these cases we should evaluate the TTF1 very carefully, and you should be aware of the false negative, false positive expression in the pneumocytes. In addition, if you are doing only the napsin as a ISC, we have to keep in mind that napsin can come positive in the alveolar macrophages, and some other non-lung tumors can also express napsin. Moving on to another case. This is a 35-year-old lady which presented with the central mass lesion, and morphologically, although it has some solid-like configuration, there are and squamoid-like appearance. Some of the cells has mucinous differentiation, or which is highlighted by the mucic armine. So, are we dealing with a adenosquamous carcinoma, or is it as was the questions? And further on immunohistochemistry, the CK7 was strongly positive, but TTF1 was negative. So, although there were some mucinous cells containing cells were there, and this the other areas were strongly and diffusely positive for P63. So this is an example of the salivary gland tumor, that is a mucoepidermoid carcinoma. So we have to keep in mind if any tumor, especially in the central region, especially in the airways, which morphologically give appear the diagnostic dilemma of either adenosquamous carcinoma or even adenocarcinoma, but which is TTF1 positive, we have to keep in mind about the possibility of a mucoepidermoid carcinomas. Giving you example of another case which we can see, there is a tumor which is clearly non-small cell carcinoma and arranged in a trabecular fashion, and so in some of the areas we can see the tumor has a clear cell morphology. So, and mucin was also present focally. So this tumor is clearly a non-small cell carcinoma, which is arranged in a solid and trabecular arrangement, and few of the cells has also illustrated the mucin. So are we dealing with a solid adenocarcinoma or not? Expected CK for, especially for the lung primary, the CK7 was positive, but to our surprise, despite the there are some cells which showed the enterocytoplasmic mucin, TTF1 was negative. And if we observe it more carefully, then this the TTF1 shows a cytoplasmic staining, so we are not very sure that whether it is a blush or it is a it has any relevance. So TTF1 can show the cytoplasmic staining in the hepatocytes, and when we did the HEPAR ISC in this case, so it came very strongly and diffusely positive for that. So this bring to another entity which is now coming as a of many of interest to the many pathologists, because these are the tumors which is called as hepatoid adenocarcinoma of the lung, which, because these tumors has a huge, very peculiar ISC profile of CK7 strong and diffuse positive, TTF1 negative, and HEPAR positive. In addition to this morphological diagnosis, these patients also have a very characteristic clinical and the molecular profile, being they are huge. Most of these patients are usually elderly male. They are heavy smokers, and these tumors are hugely negative for the biomarker for which targeted therapies are established. And recently, some investigator also has demonstrated that these group of tumors, which are CK7 positive, TTF1 negative, and HEPAR positive, are SMARCA4 positive, which is now recognized as a new diagnostic entity in the upcoming new WHO classification of the lung tumors. Moving on to some another case, which we can see as on the core biopsy, this is a tumor which has a nice glandular configuration, and so there is no doubt about this being an adenocarcinoma. And the tumor, the ISA profile shows a weak staining for CK7, but in addition 20 was also positive. And this is we did another marker which showed a strong and diffuse positivity. So is it a lung primary adenocarcinoma with acinar growth pattern? No, this is not a DTF1, but this is a CDX2. So we have to keep in mind that lung is a very fertile soil for the metastasis, and you can get adenocarcinoma from other sites to the lung, and ISC can help to resolve these situations. Another case of 35-year-old female with the pleural effusion, and the cell block shows morphologically atypical cells, and which are negative for TTFN. So whenever you encounter a cell effusion and the cell block is prepared, usually I start with a TTF1, because in most of the primary lung cancer, it resolves the it gives the definitive answer. But as in this case, you can see the TTF1 was negative, so we did additional markers to distinguish it from the mesothelial marker, and the WT1 was positive. So is it a mesothelioma considering WT1 positive? Is a young patient, and there was clinical profile was not matching with that. So we also did the Paxate, and this tumor was very strongly and was positive for the Paxate, which confirmed that this is a tumor of Mullerian origin and not of primary adenocarcinoma of the lung. So we have to keep in mind that lung can show tumors can be a metastatic rather than a primary, and in these situations ISC is of great relevance. So to summarize the story about non-small cell non-small cell carcinoma, although we know that adenocarcinoma and the squamous are the most common tumors in this group, and we have to do ISC in certain situations to distinguish between the two. And if you ask the which marker I prefer TTF1 and P40 as compared to the NAPSIN and P63. So in subtypings of non-small cell carcinoma, it has markedly improved by use of immunohistochemistry. So even so, it is always recommended to at least use these two markers. And this is the snapshot of the various diagnostic entity which we can offer on the biopsy specimens when you are using the immunohistochemistry. So if any any tumor to be labeled as a non-small cell carcinoma, favor adenocarcinoma, the TTF1 or NAPSIN expression, either it can be either diffuse or focal, but for squamous carcinoma, the expression has to be diffuse and there should be absence of TTFN expression. And as I mentioned earlier, excuse me, there is a, am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
So, okay, I thought there was some audio disturbance. So, and if you are, you don't have a facility to do these stains, then and morphologically you are not able to distinguish these tumors, then those cases we should only use the term non-small cell carcinoma, NOS, and your the NOS category should be less than 10% of the cases. Moving on to another case, as you can see, this is a tumor which is close to the pleura, and the tumor has a composed of large polygonal to epitheloid cells. And again, the diagnosis which came into the mind is it as adenocarcinoma or squamous? And this is on the high power, you can appreciate the morphology better. But in addition, we have to keep in mind, especially if the tumor is close to the pleura, about the possibility of mesothelioma, which is very well illustrated by this immunohistochemistry in this case. So if to make a diagnosis of mesothelioma, it is very well established that we should not rely on one marker, and in these situations at least two mesothelial markers and one carcinoma marker has to be done. And if you ask me about the sensitivity and specificity of the calreticulin, is quite sensitive with the sensitivity of more than 90%, but there can be situations where these immunohistochemistry can fail to give a conclusive diagnosis, and we have to rely on other modalities like BAF1 immunohistochemistry and loss of P16. Homozygous deletion of P16. They are the new markers. If there are diagnostic dilemma to distinguish between a mesothelioma versus a reactive mesothelial proliferation. Moving on to another example, here we can see that on the core biopsy there is a tumor which has a spindle shaped morphology, and there is a stroma is quite desmoplastic. So if we morphology see this tumor, then the possibility of a sarcoma come into my mind. But there is a, especially when we are, if we are practicing the pulmonary pathology, we have to keep in mind that there are some tumors, epithelial tumors in the lung that include sarcomatoid mesothelioma and sarcomatoid carcinomas, which can show spindle cell morphology, and it is our the first marker which we should use when dealing with these lesions is not a panel of sarcomas, but start with A1, A3 or any keratins which help to, if it is like in this case, you can see the nicely all the cells which has been the cell morphology, they are highlighted with this keratin. A word of caution when especially about these sarcomatoid tumors, initially start with the sarcomatoid mesothelioma because it can be diagnostically challenging because the expression of the mesothelial markers can be either absent or weak, and in these situations you have to do additional ISCs to reconfirm it. And as illustrated in this slide, so though even the best bet which comes is with the expression of the keratin which helps to distinguish it from the other tumors. Moving into other diagnostic category, that is a group of tumor which is also very clinically relevant, is a sarcomatoid carcinomas. And so these diagnostic entities only as a pathologist can tell you, tell the clinicians, and why they are important, because they are usually clinically very aggressive. So in these tumors also, the diagnosis is usually established based on the morphology, because there is no reliable markers which can help to establish the diagnosis of sarcomatoid carcinomas. And in this category, there are four tumors come in this category: the pleomorphic carcinoma, spindle cell carcinoma, and giant cell carcinoma. So all but in these cases, the best bet is to evaluate your HE slides very carefully, and there can be some areas which might show you either glandular or squamous areas. So with that, you can establish the definitive lineage very easily. As I mentioned earlier, that sarcomatoid carcinomas, this group of the tumors, they are usually very clinically aggressive and chemo resistant. And recently, it has been also found that they can show the MET exon skipping mutations and usually show high PD-L1 expression. So hence, they are potential target for the immunotherapy. Just to recapitulate again, one example of a tumor which has spindle cell morphology, but whenever any tumor shows a keratin expression, these two differentials should come into your mind: as are you dealing with a sarcomatoid carcinoma or mesothelioma, and we have to add additional ISCs to define the definitive lesion lineage. Soft pointer towards the when we are seeing this keratin expression, huge in most of the cases of sarcomatoid carcinoma, the expression is very focal, or it can be absent as compared to mesothelioma. As we are dealing with the group of spindle cell tumor, this is another example of a spindle cell tumor which shows a very characteristic vascular pattern, which is called HPC like pattern, and ISC profile illustrated that this tumor shows focal keratin positivity, MYC2 and BCL2 was also positive, so and 34 was negative. So CD34, although it is highlighting the blood vessels very nicely, it is negative in the tumor cells. So this is a example of a synovial sarcoma, and now it has been very well established that synovial sarcoma is the one of the most common sarcomas which you can encounter in the thoracic cavity. So and the closest differential for when you are seeing a synovial sarcoma in the lung are can be either sarcomatoid carcinoma, sarcomatoid mesothelioma, or SFT. So these are the list of another mesenchymal tumors which you can encounter in the lung, and the diagnostic approach for these is same as at other sites, but we have to keep in mind especially whenever you are dealing with any tumor in the thoracic cavity which symbols with the spindle cell morphology, we have to exclude three common differentials. That is it a sarcomatoid carcinoma, is it a sarcomatoid mesothelioma, or if the tumor is close to the mediastinum, is it a thymoma type A. So moving on further to that group, another group of tumors which you can encounter on the biopsy specimens is a group of neuroendocrine tumors, and now they are grouped into the one subgroup as compared to the earlier. So the classification of the neuroendocrine tumor in the lung, it differs as from the other sites, where there are three grades, that are grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3 neuroendocrine tumors in lungs. Still, we follow the same the old terminology, that is typical carcinoid, atypical carcinoid, small cell carcinoma and large cell neuroendocrine carcinomas. So although there are four histological subcategories, from clinical perspective, both the small cell and the large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma, they come under one subgroup. And whenever we morphologically suspect the any tumor with the neuroendocrine differentiation, we have to do confirm that by doing immunohistochemistry, and many times we have to do more than one immunohistochemistry markers because many times either synapto can be positive and other marker can be negative, so we have to do additional immunohistochemistries. So this just to show you some of the examples of a typical carcinoid tumors, which is a well differentiated neuroendocrine tumors. When you are dealing with these tumors, we have to very carefully evaluate two things. One is the mitosis and the presence of necrosis. So if you on a biopsy core, if you see any area which is showing a necrosis count the mitosis very very carefully, so because it can be a high grade tumor that can be atypical carcinoma. Like in this example, synapto is positive and MIP1, although it was high, but more than 20%. So what is the and I just complete a few another example. Like this is a tumor which with very scanty cytoplasm and which was strongly positive for A1, A3 and neuroendocrine markers were also positive, confirming it to be a small cell carcinoma. And in this particular case, the MIP1 was quite high. So what are the potential problems you can encounter, especially when you are dealing with the neuroendocrine group of tumors, especially on the small biopsy? First, the problem is the diagnosis of the lineage, that is it a real neuroendocrine tumor? And many times we have to do more neuroendocrine markers, as I mentioned earlier. The another problem occur because especially if the tumor which shows marked crushing on this biopsy, so in those cases it is very difficult to further categorize these lesions into the different definitive diagnostic categories. And where we encounter the problem is the problems are encountered in distinguishing between typical and atypical carcinoids, from atypical carcinoid to large cell neuroendocrine carcinomas, and large cell from small cell carcinomas. So is MIP help to in the tumor grading? Although it can help in some cases, but as per the current WHO classification, it is not a diagnostic criteria to grade the tumor. And if we have to evaluate the MIP more critically, so now it is recommended not to use only the eyeball or the visual evaluation of MIP1. The hotspot areas, that the area which shows the maximum or the highest MIP1, they should be counted using a photomicrograph. And so although MIP is relevant in giving the idea about the aggressiveness of the tumor, but still especially in the lung tumor, it doesn't have a diagnostic role, because it based on that you can't grade the tumors. And also it doesn't have a defined prognostic role. So what are the best ways to evaluate the MIP1? The commonly used is the eyeballing, which as per the current recommendations, it is recommended to avoid it. So it's always better to manually count the cells, and minimum of 500 cells should be counted in the biopsy, and 2000 cells in the resection specimen. And now as I mentioned earlier, that you can get some areas which has a high proliferation index. So these are the hotspot areas which may be more relevant. And recently, coming with a digital pathology and AI algorithms, they can predict and give the more quantitative way of NIP evaluation. As you can see in this case, the AI algorithm picked up these the cells with the brown staining, and at the end give a very precise count on the MIP1 which might be missed on the just visual evaluation. So if you can make out from this picture that not only the strong positive cells which are easy to appreciate, even the weak positive cells are picked up by this algorithm, and which can give the more precise evaluation of the MIP1. So this was about the neuroendocrine tumor. So although the MIP has relevance, but it is not a well-established parameter for the grading of the tumor. Moving on to another case, which shows a tumor which is predominantly endobronchial in the young male, and you can see the cells. These tumor cells have quite pleomorphic cells, which is negative for the initial basic panel including epithelial marker A1, A3, CK7, TTF1, which is positive in the native lung but negative in the... So in these scenarios, we have to think broadly and try additional markers. Like in this particular case, the LCA, CD30 and ALK was strongly positive. So this was the ALCL of the lung. Another rare case, but you can encounter sometimes in the small biopsy. This is a tumor which shows very small round blue cells and which is focally positive for A1, A3, and NUT was also strongly positive, confirming to the NUT carcinoma of the lung. There can be these are the situations in which we have to use immunohistochemistry. Means these are the indications where the IHC is mandatory required in the small biopsy specimens, including the tumor with a solid adenocarcinoma, large cell carcinoma, non-Kettering squamous cell carcinoma, neuroendocrine tumor, sarcomatoid carcinoma, mesothelioma, metastasis and lymphoma. So whenever the morphologicals, these are the differentials, we have to do the immunohistochemistry to definitely characterize these lesions. So in today era, we have to rely that now the diagnosis is not limited only to the morphological evaluation. This tissue has to go further subsequent molecular testing, so it's a responsibility of a pathologist to ensure that we use these small biopsies specimens very 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 judiciously, so that all possible molecular tests can be performed. So this was in short about how to deal with the small biopsies when you are dealing with the lung lesion, and with the special emphasis mainly on the lung tumors. So if we have time, I can quickly go through the new WHO which is going to be released very shortly. Dr. Nadeem, do we have time?
Yes.
So I just like to share some of the new recommendation or new updates which are going to be come in the new WHO 5th edition, and so there are these three new entities were although there are no major morphological changes in the new WHO, but we'll come to know when the book will finally release. So these three entities were newly described: bronchiolar adenomas, SMARC A4 deficient thoracic tumors. So these are the tumors of the same group in which INI1, which we are more familiar, mesothelioma in situ. And the major updates was for the invasive non-mucinous adenocarcinoma differentiation in the grading of these tumors, pleural mesothelioma grading and their molecular subtyping, and lung neuroendocrine neoplasm. So as I mentioned, that SMARCA4 deficient undifferentiated tumors. So this is coming as a hot topic because this is a recently described entity, and many of the undifferentiated tumors which we used to leave earlier are now being recognized as a SMARCA4 deficient tumor. So what are these tumors? So as you can see, the definitive diagnosis to establish is to do the SMARCA4, that is a BRG1 ISC. And so morphologically, these tumors, they can either look like undifferentiated sarcomas, or they can be carcinomas. So that means it is a very broad the broad category. So the sarcomas which shows a round cell morphology or rhabdoid like morphology, they can come into this diagnostic category. And from carcinoma perspective, as I said, mentioned like the hepatoid carcinoma, the carcinoma which has CK7 positive, TTFO negative, and HEPAR like immunophenotypes. So these are the category of the tumors which can be SMARCA4 deficient tumors, and they are also very aggressive tumors like NUT midline carcinomas. So it is the new entity which has come in the WHO. As coming to the adenocarcinomas, although morphologically there is nothing new was added, but in this new WHO, they emphasize on subcategorizing of adenocarcinoma into poor, intermediate, and good, poor, and intermediate risk. So what is the good morphological pattern? Is that adenocarcinoma with lipidic predominant growth pattern. So they are good tumors. Acinar and papillary are intermediate, and solid and micropapillary are the bad behaving tumors. So as per the new recommendations, so in addition to the morphological pattern and predominant pattern and the differentiation of these tumors, if the high grade patterns, they are present even in the in more than 20% of the areas, they should be documented and reported, because if any tumor which is having a more than 20% of the area which is either solid, micropapillary, or complex glandular, that will become as a poorly differentiated tumor. Mesothelioma in situ was described for the first time. Earlier there was no such entity. So even these are the tumors which shows a very flat lining, morphologically very difficult to identify, and the essential diagnostic criteria for to identify them is to either confirm by using BAP1 immunohistochemistry or by molecular confirmation. So this will, for morphologically, it will remain as a challenging, and I doubt I will see such case in my life. For diffuse mesothelioma, it is the morphological subtypes were same as described earlier, but here also the depending on the nuclear ATPM and mitosis, it is recommended to categorize the mesothelioma into high and low grade tumors. So the three features which is need to be paid attention when grading of this mesothelioma is about nuclear ATPM, presence of mitosis and necrosis. And further, whenever there is a diagnostic dilemma between reactive mesothelial hyperplasia and mesothelioma, the stress was given to use BAP1 immunohistochemistry. For neuroendocrine tumors, the diagnostic categories were same as earlier, but now the stress was given for the molecular subtyping of the lung neuroendocrine tumors, which was not there in the earlier classification. And based on the molecular classification, some new groups were also added, especially in the small cell and category. And for these subgroups, there are ISC markers were also evolved. So even maybe in future, even on the small biopsy, we have to make an attempt to segregate the small cell carcinomas further, as we do for the non-small cell carcinoma in future. So with this, I end my talk and by saying that the pathologists are the guardians of these limited biopsies, and we have to apply the classifications very appropriately. Use of immunohistochemistry and molecular testing is a standard practice, but standard practice, especially when you are dealing with the lung cancer management. And the molecular testing is now moving to the NGS-based platforms from a single gene assay. So the future generations need to be familiar not only with the basic immunohistochemistry and the basic ISC test, but also with the next generation sequencing platforms. So with this, I end my talk. And when dealing with this small biopsy, tissue is the most crucial thing, and it will always remain an issue unless and until it is handled efficiently. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Absolutely true. It has to be handled correctly, efficiently, and properly. Lot of questions for you, Dr. Kaushal. You can see the chat box on from one corner to the other, full of questions. Just please have a glass of water.
Can you just give me a minute? My battery is little low.
Yeah, take your time. No, wonderfully presented, very extensively handled, very crisp and good.
Okay, so should I close this presentation and then go back?
Yeah, just you can stop presenting, and on the chat box you can see questions. Just press stop presenting.
Okay.
So yeah, can you see the questions on the chat box?
Yes, I can see the questions. So. So, should I read them myself
I can read it for you. No problem. First question is by Professor Dr. Pranab Kumar Bhattacharya. What lung changes you found in TrueCut lung biopsies in SARS-CoV-19 in alveoli and interstitial space? I don't think this is relevant, because I don't think so in Tata you will be getting SARS-CoV-19.
Yeah, so although we have seen some biopsies in the known positive cases, but morphologically and they were not one thing. Most of the time they don't do the biopsy just to establish the infection. So very limited samples we have received, but very rarely we found the morphological changes in those cases.
We can go to the next question. What tumorless conditions in lung you found in your institutions that, and what are pathological changes in those tumorless?
So tumorless are the focus of neuroendocrine tumors, which has a size less than 5 mm, and these tumorless, especially if you say on biopsy specimen, it is very difficult to pick a tumorless and make a diagnosis also. So especially in the resection specimens, if you are seeing any focus which is has neuroendocrine morphology, and if it is coming close to the airways, we have to do the neuroendocrine ISC markers to confirm the diagnosis. Pathological changes, I'm not very sure what you want to ask from this particular question about the tumor. Let's if they are, most of them are incidental, they can be multiple and very commonly seen in the smokers, and that's it.
Dr. Minesh Gandhi has a question. What precautions and pitfalls in interpreting peripheral squamous cell carcinoma in small lung biopsy?
So when morphologically you are suspecting, so I'll put it other way. So now any tumors which is squamous carcinoma, usually it appears morphologically as a solid configuration. So first and foremost important thing, is it a squamous, really a squamous carcinoma, or is it a adenocarcinoma which has a solid configuration? So as he has rightly pointed out, that squamous carcinoma usually they occur in central location as compared to the periphery, where the adenocarcinomas are more common. So we have to keep in mind, especially in the peripheral lesion, is it a solid variant of adenocarcinoma, and second, is it a mesothelioma which has given you the morphological appearance of a squamous carcinoma.
Then which TTFI clone you advocate, because you know TTFI clones are, many clones behave very abnormally, you know.
So I agree that there are many clones, but we use a DACO antibody, and it works 873. That works very nice for us, and also same clone is available with many other vendors, and this DACO antibody is quite expensive also as compared to that, but it has worked very satisfactory for us. So whenever you are deciding on the clone which you have to use, so for during validation you have to choose two type of the cases. One which usually show the strong expression, which can be picked up by any of the clones, but you ought to take the cases which shows the weak expression by a standard clone. And also third thing, also try to include a bronchial mucosa or the proximal, especially from the proximal airway. So the Ventana clone SP 24 that has showed a false positivity in a large number of cases, and even the bronchial mucosa can show the positivity. So whenever any new vendor come to me to ask to check for his TTF1 clone, I try to check is it showing any false positivity in the bronchial mucosa, and test it on some weak positive cases. So how good it is working on that. And now recently there is an atlas for immunohistochemistry in the lung cancer was released by International Association of Study of Lung Cancer, and it has also very described all these things in very good detail.
Next question is, how to differentiate combined small cell carcinoma from squamous cell carcinoma with small, actually combined, you written wrongly, I think, how to differentiate the classical small cell carcinoma or HEMA is my meaning combined, yeah. How to differentiate combined small cell carcinomas from squamous cell carcinomas with small hyperchromatic cells in biopsies? Please share your experience.
So, to definitely establish the lineage, because it's one thing whenever you see or any tumor with the small cell morphology, the first differential come into the mind is about the neuroendocrine tumor, that is small cell carcinoma. But we also have to keep in mind about a small cell variant of a squamous carcinoma. So in diagnostic approach, I usually put one at the baseline, in addition to a neuroendocrine marker, P40 or one of the squamous markers, so that exclude the possibility of a small cell variant of of squamous carcinoma. So that was as a first thing to distinguish between small cell variant of squamous carcinoma or from a small cell carcinoma. Then moving on, if you are asking about the combined carcinoma, so usually the based on my experience or what we have seen, whenever there is a combined carcinoma with the squamous component, so squamous component is usually a differentiated one, and it can be easily picked up on morphology. So and which can be substantiated by the differential expression of the neuroendocrine markers.
Yeah, sometimes you might even miss it on a small biopsy, it may not be representative.
Yes.
Yeah, so because picking up combined carcinomas on small biopsies, one has to be very lucky.
Yeah, so we have seen more cases with the adenocarcinoma with the small cell.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And another thing we have to keep in mind, especially if there is a prior biopsy which is reported as an adenocarcinoma and patient was on some targeted therapy for EGFR mutation. So many of these cases shows a small cell transformation. So if you see a combined carcinoma with the adeno and small cell morphology, so first check whether the patient is it a previously treated case of EGFR mutated tumors. So in those cases, you have to report it as a the presence or absence of small cell transformation if in any case which is treated by on targeted therapy for EGFR.
Right. Dr. Nabanita Das from Assam, she says lung is a common site for METs too. So what are the common pitfalls in METs versus primary, sir? Would like to know about to avoid them with reference to H&E and then role of IHC. Oh, that's a full question. It's a full topic.
Yes.
So that's a long topic. My God, I think we will address that in a separate call. I mean, when we are handling lung carcinomas and trying to differentiate METs, it's a full chapter. It's a full long question.
Yeah.
I think I would leave it there.
Give you the common METs which you encounter in the lung, they are either adenocarcinomas or squamous carcinoma. So adenocarcinoma morphologically both adenocarcinoma as well as squamous carcinoma morphologically, it is very difficult to distinguish. There are some soft pointers like comedotype necrosis, you see dirty necrosis in the chronic tumors, but it is really very difficult purely based on the morphology. For adenocarcinoma, there are site-specific markers which you can use. And if you have to say distinguish between the metastatic squamous carcinoma, which many times clinical queries come if the patient has a head neck tumor or cervix tumor, how to distinguish them? It is IHC will not resolve them. Only P16 can help. Because primary squamous carcinoma or lung are very rarely positive for P16. So that is the only marker I do to distinguish between METs versus primary for squamous carcinomas. And very rarely also in the lung, you can get tumor to tumor metastasis also. That is another challenging thing.
Right. Then there is another question by Dr. Pranav.
I have one case in which there was a RCC met to the lung and which was picked up on biopsy.
Okay. That's good.
So
another question by Dr. Pranav Bhattacharya is, significance of the commonly used lung adenocarcinomas are for diagnostic markers including TTFI, NAPSIN-A and CK7. What is the prognosis of TTFI NAPSIN in lung adenocarcinoma?
So, for diagnosis, I completely agree that these three markers are required, but there is no need to do all three. So CK7 usually don't do CK7 because CK7 will not help to provide the lineage. So out of TTF1 and NAPSIN, I give much relevance to TTF1 because it is a nuclear marker and it is more robust as compared to NAPSIN. About the prognostic significance, usually the well differentiated tumors, like the tumor which have more acinar or lipidic patterns, they show the strong expression as compared to the solid adenocarcinoma. So in solid adenocarcinoma, the TTF1 can be negative, negative, or it can be focal. To say that is it prognostically relevant and it whether it can it be used as a biomarker, it has not yet established.
Right. The next question by Dr. Pranav Bhattacharya is, rather P53, KRAS, EGFR, ALK and vascular endothelial growth factor receptor mutation with overexpression are better markers for both purpose for diagnosis and prognosis and treatment of lung cancer?
Rather than P53, RAS, EGFR, VGF. So, I'm not very sure about it, but these the P53, KRAS and EGFR, these are the commonly used biomarker which are to be tested because there is a possible therapies available for them. For VGF, role of VGF, although there are anti-VGF inhibitors which sometimes is added to even to the conventional chemotherapy, based on our experience and our medical oncologists, they don't specially ask for VGF expression in our lung biopsy specimens. So it maybe in future it might add might become clinically relevant because the vascularity of a tumor is very much relevant, especially while targeting with some drugs. So we are not doing it routinely, but maybe in future it might come as well.
The next is a comment, and then the last question by Dr. Nabanita Das. How SMARCA4 tumor currently known as? Yeah, that's a good question. Without ancillary test, with what nomenclature to be signed out now?
So, SMARCA4 tumor, if you don't have a definitive ISC, that is BRG1 immunohistochemistry, because that is a very specific ISC, and the loss of that of SMARCA4 ISC is the only definitive diagnostic criteria. So in absence or if you don't have even even TMH, we don't have that immunohistochemistry. So these cases are labeled as either undifferentiated sarcoma or the carcinoma based on the histomorphological profile. And in the comment, you can give the possibility that this can be a SMARCA4 tumor, and when you have a facility to test for the same, you can easily pick up these cases from your archives.
Right, great. So just let me check if there are any questions. Yeah, there are comments. There are some comments. Dr. Nabanita Das says, okay, sir, so nice of sir. He's still answering. Thank you so much. I mean, I think you must be really exhausted by now. So, such an extensive topic, so many questions, and you have answered all of them so wonderfully. Right, so I think we'll call it off here today. Dr. Rajiv Kaushal, thank you so much for such a wonderful talk, so extensive, and the way you handled the questions, so many of them. Thank you so much. Wonderfully done. God bless you. Take care. Good night.
Thank you,
everybody. Bye-bye. Take care. Bye.